Good morning, and welcome to St. Paul's this morning on this warm August Sunday morning. And this is the ninth Sunday after Pentecost, if you're counting, and I'm Jason Launders, and our worship assistant today is Alice Hager. So thank you, Alice. And the altar flowers behind me are given to the glory of God in loving memory of Elsie Rehack, presented by nieces and nephews. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love endures forever. Let us confess our sins in the presence of God and of one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not followed your path, but have chosen our own way. Instead of putting others before ourselves, we long to take the best seats at the table. When met by those in need, we have too often passed by on the other side. Set us again on the path of life. Save us from ourselves and free us to love our neighbors. Amen. Hear the good news. God does not deal with us according to our sins, but delights in granting pardon and mercy. In the name of Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. We are free to love as God loves. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Also with you. Please be seated. Almighty God, you sent your Holy Spirit to be the life and light of your church. Open our hearts to the riches of your grace, that we may be ready to receive you wherever you appear. Through Jesus Christ, our Saviour and Lord. Amen. Now we have, from the Blue Book, number 748, Bind Us Together.
The first reading is from Hebrews chapter 11, verses 1 to 3 and 8 to 16. Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Indeed, by faith our ancestors received approval. By faith we understand that words were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was made from things that are not visible. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to set out for a place that he was going to receive as an inheritance. And he set out, not knowing where he was going. By faith, he stayed for a time in the land he had been promised, as in a foreign land, living in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked forward to the city that has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith, he received the power of procreation, even though he was too old, and Sarah herself was barren, because he considered himself faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one person, and this is one as good as dead, descendants were born. As many the stars of heaven as the innumerable grains of sand by the seashore. All of these died in faith without receiving the promises, but from a distance they saw and greeted them. They confessed that they were strangers and foreigners on the earth, for people who speak in this way make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. If they had been thinking of the land that they had left behind, they would have had the opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God. Indeed, he has prepared a city for them. There ends the reading.
Please stand. The gospel is from St. Luke chapter 12, verses 32 to 42. Jesus said, "Do not be afraid, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give alms. Make purses for yourselves that do not wear out, an unfailing treasure in heaven, where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Be dressed for action and have your lamps lit. Be like those who are waiting for their master to return from the wedding banquet, so that they may open the door for him as soon as he comes and knocks. Blessed are those slaves whom the master finds alert when he comes. Truly, I tell you, he will fasten his belt and have them sit down to eat, and he will come and serve them. If he comes during the middle of the night or near dawn and finds them so, blessed are those slaves. But know this, if the owner of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would not have let his house be broken into. You also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Let me ask you a question. How many of you have treasures or things that you really like at home, like a new car, a Nintendo Switch, or a really fast bike? Now, I bet there are things that you're really, really hoping to get. Now shout them out. Let me hear you. What are some things that you're really hoping to get? Whoa, you guys have a lot of things you're hoping to get. Did I hear somebody say Pokemon cards? And a new iPhone? Did somebody say a skateboard? Those are all really cool things. But what happens when your car stops working? Or your Nintendo Switch is broken? And you don't have the parts for it anymore. Or somebody steals your Pokemon cards and you don't know who or where to find them. Or while you're riding your skateboard, it breaks in half and you just can't fix it. Or there's a really bad rainstorm and your phone is left out in the rain and it's wet and ruined. Or the tires on your really fast bike pop and the spokes are broken. And your fast bike just isn't fast anymore. All of these things, while treasured for a time, are not treasures that last forever. And no matter how many of these things we purchase or receive, we will never be filled with them. It's important to remember the treasures that we need to store are those of God and not of this earth. Simply sharing God's love, or standing up for those who need a voice, are great ways to collect and build God's treasure. This week, I challenge you all to a treasure hunt. Let's see how you can keep your heavenly treasure growing. Have a great week.
Heavenly Father, we ask that my words will be from you. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, I want you to imagine you've had a life-changing decision. You've decided to go to seminary and study the Bible and theology for a few years, and you've reached the end of that study time. And it's the time for that big exam. You've prepared for it. When I used to do exams some time ago now, I used to take lots of spare pens and pencils in just in case you ran out of ink. I mean, I had enough ink to write War and Peace in some of my exams. But here you are, you're ready, you're in the examination room, you've got a small table, there's a paper turned upside down in front of you with the questions on it. And you're nervous and you're ready to go. This is it. You have to pass this exam, otherwise the last few years have been wasted. The time comes. You're given the instruction to turn over the paper. You're ready for this 3 hours of grueling brain stretching exercise in front of you. And then you just see one question on the paper. And the question is, in no more than 5 words, summarize Jesus' ministry by completing this sentence. Jesus taught us, ... You got 3 hours to think of 5 words. Now, it's really difficult, actually, to write something concisely. It's actually, when people write, they tend to write lots and lots of stuff, but keeping something small and concise to 5 words is difficult. So this probably will take you the full 5 hours, because what's the right answer? What's the wrong answer? Is there a right answer? So you think about it. What would you say? Well, I don't say it now, but would you feel comfortable answering that question? What was what Jesus taught us? Maybe you would perhaps could answer, Jesus taught us about the kingdom of God. Don't think we disagree with that. Or you could say, Jesus taught us how to enter his kingdom. Another five-word answer. I'm sure you could come up with your own. When we think of God's kingdom or heaven, some parts of the Gospels it's called the kingdom of heaven, some parts it's called the kingdom of God. Jesus talks about it an awful lot. But what comes to mind when you think of heaven? Is it a place full of gold and light? Perhaps we think of a cathedral with a marvelous ceiling rising up towards heaven, maybe with a big tower or a massive spire handling over it as it reaches to God. One example I can think of that is as a parish church in the small town in west of England. The town is called Cirencester. And you go into that very small town, and there's an enormous parish church in it. It's actually the largest parish church in England. It's not that big on the ground, but it's the largest because it's so tall. And when it was built in about the 12th or 13th century, the idea was that they had to show how close to God they were by building really tall churches. And each town tried to outdo each other. So to get close to heaven, they thought they had to build a big, tall church. And it is a beautiful church to go to, but I think they were wrong in terms of how to get to the kingdom of heaven. Perhaps heaven, we think of those big movies from the 1950s and 60s, which they ended in sort of heavenly scenes with clouds and a choir singing. I'm sure we've seen those movies. But unfortunately, I don't think any of those pictures is what Jesus paints as the kingdom of heaven. Jesus says, here are five examples of what Jesus says the kingdom of heaven is like. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed. The kingdom of heaven is like a net thrown into the sea. The kingdom of heaven is like a man scattering seed. The kingdom of heaven is not something that can be observed. Or the kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field. That's far cry from the images of big cathedrals or palaces or temples or clouds with big choirs singing in the background. But what holds all those images together that Jesus used is that the kingdom of heaven is hidden, you can't see them, and it is unstoppable. Take, for example, the yeast. The yeast makes the dough rise, and until the invention of the microscope, nobody knew how yeast worked. They just knew that yeast was yeast. The tiny mustard seed, one of the smallest seeds around there, easily missed and lost, yet it grows into a large tree that the birds can perch on. The net from the fishing boat can get thrown in. You can't see beneath the water, but fish will be caught. The seed in the parable of the sower falls onto the ground, and sometimes it takes root, and sometimes it doesn't. The kingdom of heaven, Jesus says, is not something that can be observed. It's something that is here. It is within all of us right now. The kingdom is like a treasure in a field. You have to go looking for it. And when you find it, that rich man, remember, he sold everything so he could buy that field for that pearl beyond all price. And that brings us to our reading today about treasure and the kingdom of heaven. Treasure is something I think we all understand. It's a word that appears remarkably often in the Bible. I lost count how many times it's actually there. In the Old Testament, it normally refers to God's treasured possession, which are his people, the Israelites. Multiple times he calls them his treasured possession. But what comes to mind when we think of treasure today? We've all seen young children collecting their little treasures in their box. We learn about treasure really young. Who can remember somebody collecting maybe some pebbles or some seashells or bugs or something like that? I've got a hand up at the back. Thank you. So we can all, and that child will hold on to those treasures like their life depended on it. I remember my little brother always never wanting to leave the house without his cloth, his treasured cloth. And it was tears, it was anguish. If that was forgotten, you had to turn around and go back to get it. So we learn about treasures and holding on to things when we're really small. It's like innate within us. Perhaps we think of pirates and treasure islands and chests buried beneath the sand, and then people fighting over it and killing each other for those golden jewels hidden in there, the avarice that comes from that. Perhaps we think of treasure as our security. With enough treasure, we don't have anything more to worry about. We feel secure. But I'm sure most of you have some life savings somewhere, in a bank account or maybe in some sort of mutual fund or something like that, retirement fund. And every single one of those that I've ever seen says, previous or past performance is no indicator of future earnings. They make no guarantees whatsoever. So there's really very little security in those. But really, what is treasure? It is something that we can put our faith in. In fact, treasure and faith are tightly connected in Jesus' teaching, and they are in today's reading. In today's gospel, remember that gospel means good news, Jesus had just told the parable of the rich fool. We heard about that last week. The guy who grew all these crops, he thought he had it made, he didn't have to worry about anything else. He then put all these crops into big barns which he built, and then that night his life was taken from him. Where had he put his treasure? In those barns. History is littered with examples of the rich and powerful trying to take their riches with them. Think of the pyramids, the gold, the jewels. Think of the price that was on the Egyptian people thousands of years ago, building those enormous pyramids or digging out deep, deep tombs and just putting all these treasured possessions in them. What good did it do them? Or in Europe, there were Vikings. They liked to be buried with their long ships and all their life's treasures so that they could go into the next life. Who really benefited from all those? Museums, robbers a few centuries later. Well, look at the Taj Mahal in India. It's a beautiful building. What is it? It's a tomb. It's just a tomb. The person who it's built for is really not benefiting from it whatsoever. I'm sure you could think of many more examples of who really benefits from treasure. So what about our earthly treasure, which, as Jesus points out, cannot be stolen? Can only be stolen. And it can be destroyed by moths. Perhaps in modern terminology, that's like our life savings not being safe. But Jesus tells us, do not be afraid, little flock, for it is your Father's pleasure to give you the kingdom. That's how today's gospel started. Just think about that for a minute. I mean, your Father, it's his pleasure to give you the kingdom. I mean, that's a wow moment. But what is the one thing that Jesus wants from us in return? Faith. Faith, as we are told in our Hebrew reading, is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Assurance and conviction. Both words basically mean the same thing. It means we are sure. The world may have faith in itself when making decisions, but we need faith in Jesus' teaching. Faith means we make difficult choices, the type of choices that we can't change and go back on and can have serious consequences, like those Old Testament characters we heard about in the first reading today. Abraham was promised a better country. Abraham was promised many descendants. And things nearly went really wrong for Abraham because he didn't believe that God could do that. Abraham had to take that step of faith and give up the life he knew and start on that journey of faith, which we are still continuing today. Faith means we can't dither. It's all or nothing. You can't half send that job application. You can't half accept a job. I remember a time, one of the first jobs I ever had, I was presented with this contract and a little dotted line at the end, I had to sign it. I mean, in my mind as an 18-year-old, that was a really big deal. This was a life-changing decision. Well, it really wasn't, but it felt like it at the time. You know that when you're making that decision to accept that contract, to go down a different path, you know it's an all or nothing decision. Faith means being ready. If you try and keep your treasure on earth, how can you really be ready? And another interesting observation from today's Hebrews reading is this. It said this, by faith we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was made from things that are not visible. This brings us to one of the big questions that the church has been asked for centuries. It's grappled with it for centuries. But the truth is that science can't answer every single question. You can't prove that God made the universe. There is no experiment you can do to prove that. You have to take it by faith. There can never be enough evidence to prove to some people that God made everything. But the answer is here in Hebrews. It says, God made the universe, everything, from what is not visible. And science can't disagree with that. So then, if we are ready and the Master comes, as in today's gospel reading, he actually wants to give you all the treasures of heaven and serve us. Think about that. In that gospel reading today, Jesus uses his example of the Master coming back late from a wedding banquet. So your Master's coming back late from a party. He's exhausted. He just wants to flop down. But he finds his servants ready and waiting for him. What does he do? He serves his servants. Or just think about that. How often have you come in and after a long day's work and served the person waiting for you at home? In the first century, the slaves were nothing. And this big, rich, important person comes back and starts serving you. That's the kingdom of God. It's where the master, we know who that is, actually wants to serve us. He wants to give us his treasure. He wants us to experience the kingdom, but we have to be ready. So what do you treasure most? Or turning that around a little bit, what do you put your faith in? There you know what your treasure is. If you put it into earthly treasure, are you investing it properly? Or how do you invest in heavenly treasure? By showing love for your fellow humans, whoever they are. And I think the confession that we say at the moment really, really sums that up nicely. I'm just going to read this, what we have read earlier today. It says, instead of putting others before ourselves, we long to take the best seats at the table. When met by those in need, we have too often passed by on the other side. When we do that kind of thing, we are not storing up treasure in heaven. We want to turn that around and not pass by them on the other side. That is how we store treasure in heaven, where it will not be eaten by moths, it will not be destroyed, it will not be stolen. And so are you ready? This is my last charge to you today. Are you ready? And to remember that the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. We do not know. We cannot wait to start getting ready, to start getting heavenly treasure. We have to do that now. Thank you. Let us move on to our musical selection.
Please join in singing 10,000 Reasons.
Living together in trust and hope, let us confess our faith, sharing together the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Trusting in God's extraordinary love, let us come near to the Holy One in prayer. Let your loving kindness be upon your church. Fill all who proclaim the gospel with your Spirit. Equip your flock to speak your word of promise and hope in the midst of fear and uncertainty. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Let your loving kindness be upon your creation. Dwell among us and sustain our earthly home. In places of famine, provide nourishment. In places of plenty, fashion us to be good stewards of your bounty. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Let your loving kindness be upon your world. Be our helper and our shield in places torn by strife and violence. Raise up courageous leaders to govern with compassion and justice. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Let your loving kindness be upon your children. Look upon all who wait for your steadfast love. Console those who grieve and embrace those who cry out to you, especially those on our prayer list. Help us to trust your promise and not to be afraid. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Let your loving kindness be upon this community. Fashion our hearts to strive for the way of peace. Strengthen the outreach ministries of this congregation and all who care for those in need. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Here, other intercessions may be offered, aloud or in your heart. Merciful God, receive our prayer. With thanksgiving, we remember all who have died in faith and now rest in you. As they place their hope in you, so strengthen us to trust in your promise of new life. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Receive the prayers of your children, merciful God, and hold us forever in your steadfast love. Through Jesus Christ, our holy wisdom. Amen.
So, I would like to say thank you on the behalf of the Church Council and for all your continuing support for our ministry here at St. Paul's. Our offerings are greatly appreciated and enable us to reach out and witness in service to our community. Now, let's take a moment to ask God's blessing upon our offerings. God of love, you call us beloved children, and fill us with your grace. Receive our lives and the gifts we offer. Abide with us and send us in service to a suffering world for the sake of your beloved child, Jesus Christ. Amen.
let me lift up those who are weak. May the prayer of my heart always be, make me a servant, make me a servant, make me a servant today.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. The God of peace, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you, comfort you, and show you the path of life this day and always. Amen.
Rejoices, open the gates before him, lift up your voices. Who is the King of glory? Who shall we call him? He is Emmanuel, the promise of ages. The King of glory comes, the nation rejoices. Open the gates before him, lift up your voices. In all a Galilean city or village, he goes among his people, curing their illness. King of glory comes, the nation rejoices. Open the gates before him, lift up your voices. Singing of David's son, our Savior and brother, in all of Galilee was never another. The King of glory comes, the nation rejoices. Open the gates before him, lift up your voices. He gave his life for us, the pledge of salvation. He took upon himself the sins of the nation. The King of glory comes, the nation rejoices. Open the gates before him, lift up your voices. He conquered sin and death, he truly has risen. And he will share with us his heavenly vision. King of glory comes, rejoices. Open the gates before him, rejoices.
So a few brief announcements. No need to sit down. Following this service, there is a fellowship down in the fellowship hall. We haven't had that for a long, long time, have we? And there is some finger food, but we also have meatballs from Alice. But there are donuts and fruit and other things. But we look forward to that and look forward to meeting everybody downstairs after service. That's been hosted by the transition team. And we have done a pretty good job in getting surveys back. But if you haven't done one yet, it is not too late, I understand. So please come and join us after the service. Of course, if you're remote, I'm sorry. And any other announcements that I've missed? Good. Go in peace. Love your neighbor. Thanks be to God.